Happy Father's Day. Happy Sunday. Good morning. Welcome, everyone.
Standing outside the door. But still you're searching for someone who understands the pain that you've been through. With the doors unlocked, the lights are on. What are you waiting for? Come on in, welcome home. You are loved, you belong here and now. No matter where you've been, just come on in.
Happy Father's Day to each and every one of us. So whether you're a grandpa, grandma, aunt, uncle, school teacher, male or female, each of us in some way has had an opportunity to father a child in some fashion. So we celebrate this wonderful Father's Day. So gather your friends, your family, whether on the phone or by text, and tell them to come on in to our virtual congregation this morning, as we celebrate with each and every one of you the ability to gather and to share this time together. So if you haven't met me yet, I'm Bev Spivey. I am so happy to co-minister here with my husband, Reverend Lawrence Palmer. You'll be hearing from him in a little while. And our wonderful musicians whom James McCoy has led for almost 10 years. So welcome once again.
So glad to be here. Good morning, everyone. You know, the good thing about the live stream is you can sit there and have your pancakes in your pajamas while we have church.
That's
hungry. A really good thing. So we hope you're having your pancakes in your pajamas right now. Won't you please welcome Mr. John Rose at the piano and the keyboard, Mr. Orlando Machado at the drum set, and Karina Iglesias is, of course, our featured soloist. And let's see, we have music from the Beatles, from Holly Dunn, and from Eric Clapton this morning. There you go.
Quite a range, as usual. Well, if we look at the theme that we've had all of 2020, seeing life through a spiritual lens, the theme of perfect vision. How can we keep an awareness to lift our view, to see things from a higher perspective? That's what we are working on all year long. Because indeed, when we can get calm and centered and entertain other perspectives, it gives not only a calmness to us, but our entire community and world. Doesn't mean we don't take action and get involved with things, but it does mean that we do it with a clear head and an open heart. So our whole 2020 is focused on seeing life through a spiritual lens. Of course, this month, our theme is well-being. And we have an affirmation that I'd like you to share with me. My heart knows well-being, no matter what the circumstance. Let me say it now according to what the affirmation on the screen says. My heart knows well-being no matter the circumstances. My heart knows well-being. And the heart can feed the mind, and we can teach ourselves to have just an automatic sense of well-being for ourselves and others. So let's close our eyes now and tune in together, taking a deep breath, releasing it, and opening our eyes, our internal eyes, opening our heart, opening our mind to receive whatever inspiration may come to you in this next hour, through our music, through our message, through the remembrance of our fellowship and our wonderful warm gathering here. For there will be a day when we gather again. And until then, we gather virtually with just as much energy, enthusiasm, joy, and loving kindness as ever. And so it is. Amen.
Oh, this is a unity standard. We've been singing this song for years. Let's all sing together. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes
of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes
of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes
of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes
of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
And now that we have your attention and you're gathering around to be part of this service, we want to give you an official welcome and let you know that we are live, of course, through our website, our live stream there will be available to you all week. And after that, our podcast of the clip of the 20-minute lesson is available also. So unitypompanobeach.org is our website, in case you happen to be on Facebook or elsewhere this morning. So unitypompanobeach.org. And of course on Facebook, keep that in your mind to go there often during the week. Some of you are on Facebook every day, so check us out, Unity of Pompano Spiritual Center. So welcome to everybody. We always want to let you know you are included here, whether you're very new or whether you've been here a lot of times. We have many things coming up for you to take advantage of. And all of our things are online going through Zoom. for all of our events on Zoom, we do require you to register, and then you are sent a link to get into the meeting. This assures the privacy and the security of that meeting, and we have had no difficulty at all in all these months of doing it. That link also, the registration, you just simply have to put in your name, your email, and your phone, and it gives an opportunity for you to donate. And we ask that you consider giving something to show that you believe in the value of what we're doing here, and we thank you for that. So this week coming up, Tuesday night, is a very important presentation by Dr. Anthony Silvani. And he's been preparing this for quite a while, letting people know in other venues. He's presented information about COVID, and sad to say, our numbers are not declining significantly, so it's important that we all pay attention. This is a free event for you. And Dr. Silvani is a doctor of osteopathy. He also has a doctorate in pharmacy. He was dean of osteopathic medicine at Nova Southeast University. He's board certified in family medicine and public health, has held many positions. So I'm sure you will want to take advantage to come on in. Please register through our website. You'll see the link there. And it'll begin on Tuesday night at 7. We'll allow time for his presentation and then questions and answers afterwards. So come on in. You'll all be able to be on the screen and participate with your questions. So that's on Tuesday night. On Thursday night is Peace in the Midst, which is our regular meditation service on Thursday nights, led by one of our prayer chaplains here and hosted by the lead chaplain, Dina Shimmick. So it's a time for meditation, for lengthy meditation, and those who tune in are finding it so very helpful. This too you need to register for, if you would please, and then that begins Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. And of course, we always have Power Hour on Sunday mornings, right before this service, from 9:30 to 10:30, led by our licensed Unity teacher, Cynthia Roberts. And there are, wow, sometimes 15, 20 or more people coming on into Power Hour. This is a time of discussion and hearing Cynthia's insights and then having an opportunity to share and comment. So please do take advantage of that. We ask for a $10 donation to Power Hour if you're coming to that. And of course, we always invite you to move from Power Hour, get a cup of coffee and a little more pancake if you want, and come on in then for our Sunday services live every Sunday at 11. So I believe that concludes my announcements, and now's our opportunity to remember each other. When we're in person, we actually move around and hug and greet. That's the one thing we can't do for you right now, but you can certainly sit there or move around your household and remember all of those in our congregation here, our spiritual community, but certainly all around in our community, the nation, and the world. So let's greet each other virtually.
All you need is love. All is all you need. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. Love, love, love. All you need is love. All you need.
Nothing you can know that isn't known. Nothing you can see that isn't shown. There's no way you can be that isn't where you're meant to be. It's easy. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love.
Love is all you need.
I have the privilege of sharing the daily word with you on this wonderful day. And our word for today is Father's Blessing. I give thanks for all expressions of fatherly love. My relationship with my father may have been positive and nurturing or difficult and challenging. He may have been a strong presence during my childhood, or he may have been absent. We may be a part of each other's lives today. We may be estranged, or he may have passed from earthly life. Whatever our circumstances, I bless my Father and I see him enfolded in divine love. As I honor my Father, I also honor all the father figures who have helped guide me along my path. Family members, teachers, neighbors, clergy, employers, and friends, I bless them as I recall the ways each one, in a unique way, has modeled strength, guidance, wisdom, and patience. Their presence remains with me thanks to their gifts of fatherly love. And from Proverbs chapter 4, I have taught you the way of wisdom. I have led you in the paths of righteousness.
Right now, we'd like to begin a time of prayer and meditation by singing in this very room.
Oh,
I invite you now, wherever you are, to find that very comfortable and familiar position for your body. And as you begin to settle into that position, you can give your body that loving permission to relax, to let go, to let be. And with that loving permission, your body will immediately move its focus from the outer to the inner. You can give your mind that same loving permission just to relax and to be. And with your body at ease and your mind at ease, your awareness is free to commune with Spirit. And in this time of stillness, I invite you to imagine being enfolded in the strength of Spirit. Strength is one of the qualities that we see in the masculine side of God. It is one of the qualities in the masculine side of our fathers, of strength. And however it is that that is represented to you, imagine it now. If it's a solid floor to stand on, if a strong hand to touch you, a strong lap to sit on, a strong embrace to protect you. We are enfolded in that pure presence of Spirit. Let that presence be to you now, strength. Now, as we have prepared, let us join together, sinking our hearts into that deepest part of ourself, that secret place of the Most High. And let us be together in the oneness. Now, as you prepare to move your awareness to your space and your time, back to your body, you know that even an instant during which your awareness is immersed in that deep of your heart, that healing and transformation take place. And you know that you can bring with you into your body, your mind, your heart, the essence of this experience. And in this coming week, as you choose to, you can return to this experience and be blessed all over again. So with a deep sense of gratitude, I invite you to take a deep, slow breath in through your nose. Hold it for a moment. Exhale slowly through your mouth. When you're ready, open your eyes and we will sing together, Alleluia.
Alleluia, 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 Alleluia.
I remember Daddy's hands folded silently in prayer and reaching out to hold me when I had a nightmare. You could read quite a story in the calluses and lines. Years of work and worry had left them all behind. And patted my back for something done right. There are things that I've forgotten that I loved about this man, but I'll always remember the love in Daddy's hands. Daddy. Sacrificed unselfishly just to keep us all fed. If I could do things over, I'd live my life again and never take for granted the love in Daddy's hand. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel. Daddy's hand.
That's Karina playing the guitar.
Thank you so much, man.
That's about as country as we get here.
That song was for me, so thank you, man, very much. James, I'll have to confess, I had this wicked fantasy earlier when I heard you preparing Love, Love, Love to go and get a kazoo for the wah, 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 wah part, but knowing how you feel about the Beatles, I couldn't bring myself to do it.
Thank you.
Well, it's so good to get to be here with you virtually on Father's Day. I have four things to share with you. The first one is I'd like to tell you a bit about my father. Since my relationship with him had a lot to do with who I am now and the things that I say, thought it might help for you to have a little bit of an idea about him. Daddy was born in 1912, so if he were alive today, he'd be 108 years old. That seems like a long time ago. He was born to a large, poor country family. His father died when he was very young, so he did not really have an immediate father presence with him, and he learned that the way that you lived a good life was to work hard. He was a good man and a kind man, and he worked hard. From the time I was about 4 years old until I got married, Daddy worked away from home. So during that period of time, I actually saw him about 6 weeks out of the year. And when he was home, we hunted and fished and worked and fixed things around the house, and that was his being home with us. So I have a picture of me and him after we had been fishing with a long string of red bellies and goggle eyes and sun perch between us, and I treasure that picture. Daddy had a fifth grade education, and he could fix anything. It just amazed me as a kid to watch him do that, and I learned a lot from him, and I think I kind of inherited that handyman tendency. I like to work with my hands. I like to do things and fix things like he did, and it always makes me feel close to him when I do one of those things. I have several things that Daddy left behind. One of them is this ring that I have on. It was made out of a stainless steel bolt. The place where he worked, he had access to metalworking tools, and he made this ring. Actually, he made me another one too, a signet ring, again out of a stainless steel bolt. And this past year, when my oldest grandson graduated from high school and was preparing to go away to college, as a gift to him from his great-grandfather, I took that signet ring and had my initials ground off of it and had my grandson's initials put on it and gave it to him, hoping that one day he would pass it along to some of his offspring as well, and that love that went into that creation would continue. I also have some other things. I have a hunting knife that Daddy made. He made a number of knives, kitchen knives and hunting knives. And one thing, I'm sorry that I forgot to bring it with me, it's called a jumping jack. It's a little toy. It's a little bitty man tied together with string mounted between two sticks, and when you push it like this, the little man jumps around in circles. And I have what I think is the last one that Daddy made. He made quite a few of them to give away, but I have that one, and I don't know which grandchild is going to inherit that one as he goes along. But I have a lot of memories about being with Daddy, even in spite of the short time that I had with him. Two of them I'd like to share with you. One is we were building a shed around our pump. We had a deep well pump, and we're building a shed around it, and we were in the latter stage of it, putting the electricity in, and Daddy sent me in the house to take the fuse out. We didn't have breakers back then. It was the old glass fuses that you screwed in and out, and Daddy told me which one it was and told me to go take it out, and I got back outside again, and he said, "Now, son, did you take the right fuse out?" "Yes, sir, Daddy. I got the right one out." And for some reason, he didn't have regular wire-cutting tools with him. He had a pair of old mule shears, the great big scissors that you trim manes and tails with, and he was cutting into this wire. And he discovered I didn't take the right fuse out. And he cut into that wire, and a big ball of fire shot out like this, and he slung those things like this, and they came by my head and missed my head by about an inch. And stuck in the wall behind me. And you know in the movies and the cartoons when a sword goes wah, 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 wah. Well, those scissors were going wah, 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 like that behind my head. And I didn't know whether to cry or wet my pants or laugh or what to do. And the only thing Daddy did, he looked at me and he said, "Son." And that was it. That was as far as it went. So he wasn't a very demonstrative person. But that was a great memory I have. Now I can laugh about it. I was a little bit scared to laugh then. The other time when he laughed, we'd been down to the creek fishing and caught a great big old mud cat. And you know, those things, it's hard to kill them even when you cut their heads off. But he was on the string and had his mouth hanging open like this. And I was about 8 years old. And I looked down and I saw this row of teeth. And I said, "Boy, look at all those teeth." And I put my finger in this thing's mouth. And he closed on my finger like this. And I yanked my finger out and left about half the skin in the fish's teeth, and Daddy laughed, and I tell you, it was wonderful. All the trauma of having my thumb damaged was worth it to hear him laugh over that situation. So there were a few memories like that that I have that I keep today and treasure to this day. So those are some of my memories. The second thing I'd share with you is that Some of you have had really wonderful fathers, and you have great memories, and you had a great example that was set before you. So what do you do on Father's Day? I would encourage you to honor that father that was for you, a model of health and wholeness and caring, and celebrate that memory and celebrate that person. If your father's still alive, be sure that you contact him and say directly how much you appreciate and how much you love him. If you can call, if you can text, however it is that you contact him, please do that. Don't take it for granted. Some people who have really wonderful family lives take that for granted because they've never known anything else. And I encourage you, don't take it for granted and find some way to express that appreciation to your father on this very special day, regardless of what kind of expression that may be. That's especially important because there are people who did not have very good relationships with their fathers. The father was either absent or abusive or just neglectful. And when we bring up this idea of Father's Day, a lot of people want to just run and hide. They hate going to the store to buy a card because the card say, oh, you were always there for me. You did everything for me. And that what didn't happen for that person. Perhaps it's you. If that happened to you, there's something I need to say that sounds, so hear me all the way through here because it sounds at first a little bit negative or not very optimistic. But when we are designed as human beings to have that presence of Father, and when that Father energy is absent, there's a hole in our heart. Now, a lot of people go through life grieving that hole in their heart and doing all kinds of things to compensate for it, to make up for it. Sometimes they try even harder to get Father's attention or to please Father. And the interesting thing about it, this can go on even after the Father is gone, after the Father passes, after the Father is dead. Children can still go on trying to somehow find that approval that they didn't get. Now, this is something that goes with us on and on, all the way through life. But it's not something that we have to be in that place of grieving forever. Now, there's a difference in grieving and sadness. Grieving is like an open wound that's bleeding. And sadness is the scar that is left behind after that wound heals. And it's much better to live in sadness than in grief. Grief has its purpose. It has its meaning in the moment as a short-term way of coping with loss. But it is not meant to live in that place. Your body is not designed to handle the stress of ongoing grief. So it is important that we're able to move from grief into sadness. And there's some ways that we can do that. One of the ways that we do that is by looking at forgiveness. Now, people have a lot of trouble with forgiveness when they've been hurt badly because they think forgiveness means to say, oh, it's okay that you hurt me. It's okay that you were a bad person. And that's not what forgiveness means at all. Forgiveness means to let go. It means to say, here's the situation that I experienced, and I have the memory of this experience, and I don't like it very much, but I'm not going to hang on to it and drag it around with me everywhere I go. So forgiveness is a way of letting go, of not holding on to something. Even though you may remember it, it's a matter of not living in it. You can live with that memory, but you don't have to repeat the experience over and over again. Another way of dealing with that hole in your heart and that pain that you might feel from a father who was not a good father is to have compassion. Because for a human father, a human being, who is not willing or able to be a good father, there has to be some turmoil going on inside. There has to be some bad feelings, bad thoughts that cause that kind of behavior for a father not to be a father. And having compassion for that man can help you heal as well. It may do nothing for him. He may be already gone and know nothing of what you're feeling. But if you can feel compassion for that father who wasn't a father, it will help you heal. It will help you move from that place of grief into a place of sadness, which is a much better place to be. Now, there's one other thing I would share with you, and this is a bit controversial. Not the first time I've ever said anything like that. But I've had people come to me and say, you know, I've heard about reincarnation. I've heard about this teaching that you choose your parents before you come here. And I got a question because my parents were lousy parents. I didn't get a single good thing from them. Why in the world would I have chosen them? And I thought about that for a long time because I had more than one person to bring that question to me. And I wanted to be able to respond to it in some kind of reasonable way. So I thought about it a great deal, and finally it came to me that I think that if that is the case, let's just assume for a moment that is the case, that we do indeed on some level, in some way, choose our parents before we come here. Why would we choose those people who are not going to be good parents? And I really think that as we have the sense of the gene pool that comes together, the gene pool that your mother brings, the gene pool your father brings, and those come together, and out of that combined gene pool, you came. So you were given the genetic coding that made you uniquely you by the combination of those two people. So even if you can't say thank you to Father for being a great father and teaching you so many wonderful things, you can be grateful to that Father for bringing you here, for making you who you are, for giving you the genetic material that allows you to be who you are and allows you to become who you are becoming. And again, this is in that process of moving from the grief of absence or lack into sadness, which is not terminal. Sadness is something that we can indeed live with. So if your experience with Father was not a good one, if Father's Day is not a time of real celebrating for you, then you can use this time to check your own heart and say, okay, I can live in sadness with the truth of the matter that is here. Now, these two things, having a good father, having a bad father, are representations of three-dimensionality, representation of human life here and now. And that is something that we need to learn more and more about. But there's another area that's important for us regarding Father's Day, and that is understanding the father archetype. And I've talked with you about archetypes before. Archetypes are symbols and images that are universal. They are present across all time, across all cultures, all religions. There are this group of what we call archetypes that are there no matter what. And there is an archetype of mother, and there's an archetype of father. Now, the archetype of mother points us to nature, to matter, to the earth. Matter of fact, you've heard that phrase, Mother Earth. So in this universal energetic way, then the archetype of mother points back to the earth. Now, the archetype of father points us to the realm of light and spirit and heaven. You've used the phrase Father Sky, Mother Earth and Father Sky. So the archetype of father points to that realm of heaven. And out of that realm of heaven comes the wind. Wind, the Hebrew word for wind is ruach. In the very first chapter of Genesis, the scriptures tell us that the Spirit of God moved across the face of the waters. And spirit there is the word ruach. It means breath, wind, air. It means the movement of spirit. And there's another interesting word there when it says that the Spirit of God moved across the waters. In some of the older translations, it says God, the Spirit of God brooded over the waters. And any of you have ever been around farming in the country, you know that the chickens and the hens that brood the little ones, and they'll gather up and fluff up and gather all the little ones underneath them. That's the sense that we get in this matter of creation, when the Spirit of God was moving over the waters, when Father Sky was moving over Mother Earth. This energy of these images is present all around us and always will be. The sun and the rain also are parts of this masculine energy and represent these fertilizing forces that impregnate the receptive earth. The images of piercing and penetration, such as a phallus, a knife, a spear, an arrow, a ray, all pertain to the spiritual father, the archetype of father. Now, that reminds me of a story. It's not one of those. When I was in Colorado, we had a group of people who were very interested in pagan things. And we embraced that and we celebrated that. So we had a maypole ceremony. I won't get into all the details of it, but with the maypole ceremony, you cut a tree down about 20 feet tall. You make it tall as you want to, actually. And you tie a bunch of ribbons on the top of it. And then in a ritual dance, you dance around the pole and wind the ribbons in a very deliberate way, in a braiding fashion around the maypole. And it's really beautiful when you're finished with it. And actually, the maypole comes from an ancient pagan fertility rite. And it was done during a time of the year to encourage the earth to participate and be involved and be fruitful. And when we finished with it, we were going to take it down. And after a certain period of time, I can't remember how long it is, you're supposed to put it back up and unwrap it in another kind of ceremony. Well, in the meantime, some of our folks thought it was so pretty and so amazing, we should have it in church. So we brought it up and put it right up at the front on the platform, leaning up against the wall, against our stained glass window, much like this one. And I couldn't help but think, every time I walked in the church for that month that was there, here's this great big giant phallic symbol in the middle of church, wrapped with ribbon. And nobody but just two or three of us knew what it was really like. So people can say, oh, how beautiful that is. Oh, how wonderful that is. And I resisted the temptation to say, do you realize what you're looking at here? Giant phallic symbol, right? Well, we got away with that and we let it go. We took it down. We did our ceremony, unwrapped it, and it was wonderful. But I never did it again. But this is one of the symbols, the images of the masculine archetype, the father archetype that is all around us and in the consciousness of humankind. Some of the other things that go along with the image of the masculine, the father archetype, are flying, or light, or illumination. These are all part of that principle. Also, it shows up in the world through law and order and discipline, rationality, understanding. All of those things that represent strength come across through that archetype of father. Now, it's important to know that this archetype is present in the human psyche, in all of us, all of us. The father archetype is present in females as well. Now, the father archetype is manifested in a woman's life in a different way. The texture of a woman's representation of the father archetype is different than a man's representation of the father archetype. It is also true that the mother archetype is present in all men, and the way they represent, they portray that or express that has a different texture than it does in a woman. So this is present with us all around all the time. So one of the things that we can do with that is to use that in this process of moving from grief to sadness. Because if you had that, if you're one of those who had not the ideal relationship with your father, and you feel that hole in your heart that I've just told you that you can never fill with anything else, it's always going to be there, you can find some solace, some comfort by looking out into the world and seeing those representations of the father archetype all around you. When you see an example of appropriate power, when you see an example of strong love, when you see an example of order and discipline, you can say, now that is father energy, and I want to touch that. I want that to be a part of myself. I want to emulate that. I want to receive that. And that helps us to heal that place within us and move from the grief of the lack of father to a place of sadness. And that place can be managed. That place can be handled in a different kind of way. So we have people among us who had a wonderful experience with father, and we're really happy for that. Celebrate it, honor it, always let that be expressed. Do not take it for granted. And we have those among us who had not pleasant experiences with father, and I've offered you some interesting possibilities to healing that grief of the lack of father and moving into sadness. And we look around us and we see that universal presence of the archetypal father all around us and in us, everyone. So we're never left without that presence of spirit. We're never left without that influence of healing and wholeness that is within us. Now, I'd like to close today with a poem that I wrote. My father died in 1988, and a couple of years after his death, I wrote this poem. And I matted it and framed it and gave one to my mother and had one for myself. That picture that I told you about earlier of me and Daddy holding the fish up between us when I was 10 years old. I put this poem beside that. Matter of fact, it's in my office if you want to go see it sometime. Dear Daddy, it seems that we only brushed each other's sleeve in passing. So little known and shared, immense possibilities untouched and untasted. To you, I said, I love you. You heard and you knew. With skillful hands, you taught me to sharpen a knife, to hammer a nail, to clean a fish. With your quiet life, you taught me to believe in the pregnancy of silence. In my growing and challenging, I wonder if you learned from me. I can easily weep now with thoughts of you and me, but these tears less bitter than before, even with a hint of sweetness in the drops. For the brief blinks of touching from the span of your life, through the living lessons of working and playing, I am richer, I am more, and I am grateful. Happy Father's Day.
Oh my goodness. Well, one thing I want you to look forward to, the information is going to be on our website and ready for you this week. Lawrence is going to be teaching another class, and it will begin July 7th for 4 weeks. And it's all about becoming a hyperhuman, not hyperactive, not stressed out, but hyper in the sense of awareness. In that sense of bringing our spiritualness and our humanness to the point that we are living from the spiritual side. We are hyper in our humanity. With, as my 3-year-old granddaughter who has watched Frozen and any number of things, I'm teaching her about power. I've told her she has power. And right now we're talking about the power of her to smile and be happy and make other people happy. But see, we all have power to be hyper humans and deal with healing from a physical and emotional level and many other things. So put on your calendar for the month of July on Tuesday nights from 7 to 8:30. Lawrence will be teaching a class on Zoom, and you'll be able to look at our website and take advantage of registration for that. It's going to be such a nominal cost at $10 per session. We would ask all of you to just make it easier with the Zoom confirmations and sending out the link, and go ahead and pre-register for that and pay $40 at once, and then you'll be all set. So look forward to that. We'll have more information on the website. Right now, we want to give all of our thoughts to supporting Unity of Pompano Beach. And I tell you what, I mentioned last week about getting a little bit of money from Amazon Smile. Oh my goodness, we have shopped more than we thought. You know, maybe shop till we drop, right? Smile.amazon.com has sent us 400... I wrote it down somewhere. $474 so far this year. So thank you so much. That certainly will pay a utility bill or any number of other things at no cost to us. So if you haven't taken advantage of signing up on Amazon, do that. There are other ways that you can give, and John has a slide that he'll show you. Of course, hey, cash is always good. Checks are always good. You can mail your checks into the office here at the address on our website. You see on that website is the donate button. You can always use that to send in your donation. You can set that up also to do a recurring donation. If you know you're going to give continually, just set it up and then it's automatic and easier for you too. We have an online bill pay, again, no cost to you, no cost to us when you send your checks through your bank and bill pay. And of course, we do the text to give now. If you type in, text in give and the number is on the screen, that will also automatically come in. So we thank you in all of these many ways. As we continue on and on with our virtual services, I am so happy that so many of you are faithful to your giving, and we thank you so very much. So let's bless our offering with one that I grabbed the copy today, an offering blessing that we've used many times. Together, if you're there and know it, I know you remember it. With a grateful heart, we acknowledge God of source as source of all that is. Today, we let go of any concern of lack, and we allow good to unfold in our lives. Good is ours. good and more good is ours, and ever-increasing good is ours. Everywhere we go, we see this good. We feel it, we experience it, we freely give it, and it multiplies itself around us, all of us. And so it is. Amen. And now to our band. Once again, it's time for us to say Happy Father's Day and close this service. We hope that you certainly enjoy your day and reflect on your spiritual community and stay involved with us this coming week. So as we say goodbye for today, let's bless each other with unity's prayer for protection. Let's wait for Lawrence to get up here with me. The light of God surrounds us. We are the light of God. The love of God enfolds us. We are the love of God. The power of God protects us. We are the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. We are the presence of God. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
Father's Day.